For our year-end broadcasts, we thought we'd let you hear from the team of producers who bring you our NewsHour Weekend stories each week to gain some insight into our production and journalistic process, and maybe even hear a few war stories along the way. NewsHour Weekend's Hari Sreenivasan recently sat down with a team of Chris Booker, Laura Fong, and Mori Rothman.
All right, Chris, let's start with you. Let's talk about one of the pieces that mattered to you, moved you this year.
So in July, my producer and I, Laura Fong, we went down to Hooper's Island on the eastern shore of Maryland. And basically, the eastern shore of Maryland is known for its crabs. Everybody goes to Maryland, everybody eats Maryland crabs. But this year, they were missing about 40% of their workforce.
The American crab picker is gone by the wayside. The older ladies have died off, and the younger ladies now want a full-time job. We only offer 8 months out of the year. We're seasonal. So they want something that they can count on year-round with benefits, and we don't offer that.
Like others in the area, Harry Phillips has gotten around the shortage of American workers with the migrant workforce, hired season after season, and brought legally to the U.S. on H-2B visas.
In the past, the visas were issued on a first-come, first-served basis. But this year, due to record demand, the Department of Homeland Security switched to a lottery system, which meant that if I'm Crab Company X and Laura is Crab Company Y, we apply. And if I'm selected in the lottery, I'm able to get all of my visas. If Laura is not selected, she gets none of her visas.
Got it.
And so there were a number of crab houses on Hooper's Island that had no workers. They were sitting there empty, the height of their season.
So Laura, tell me, how do you make this interesting TV? He just laid out why this is important for businesses and so forth, but when you're doing your research, when you're trying to figure out where we go to shoot this?
Yeah, it was tricky because one of our main characters, Harry Phillips, he had no workers. So what do you film?
So empty bags where people would be,
right? I basically filmed an empty room where there was a table and no people, and that was his story, that he needed those workers in order to make, you know, his business work.
What are these companies going to do next year?
So speaking with a number of the fishermen, they are in a situation where they don't know. They don't know what will happen. Maybe they'll get selected in the lottery. Maybe they won't. Maybe they'll be able to extend some of the visas they had from last season into this season. Maybe they won't. It's a really a gray area right now. And unfortunately, they're caught in this perfect storm of politics and economics.
I can't do it 2 years in a row, no. If we don't get our workers another year, we'll shut the doors, either that or we've even considered, there's crabs in Mexico, and we've been checking to see what's going on, and we're gonna fly down there this winter.
To see about maybe setting up shop there?
Setting up shop in Mexico. The ladies are there, they're all willing to work. The crabs are there. This is all I know. I don't have much education, and I do know what I'm doing here. So. What else can we do? You know, we can't sit here idle.
That was a very strange comment from him. We didn't expect it. It kind of took us off guard.
He hasn't gone yet.
As far as we know, he hasn't. He was able to get some workers late in the season, so he has not made that move. Mm-hmm. But the fact that he was even considering it, being a native of, you know, the eastern shore of Maryland for so many generations, we were shocked that he even considered it.
Yeah, he's a third generation fisherman. And you know, a lot of times I think we're looking to tell big stories through small windows. And I think this is a perfect example of that. I mean, you know, you're really trying to look at stories through a person's individual experience. And you're trying to find stories that include the bigger things that may be more difficult or more complicated to talk about, but you can really clearly see, wow, this is a policy that's having a direct impact on people. Mm-hmm. And there's really no black or white. It's remarkably gray. It requires a bit of nuance in the way we look at things.
Okay, not all of our stories are big policy issues. You and Mori have been kind of on a hot streak this year of going to some beautiful places. Let's talk about a couple of those.
Yeah, so I'll give it to you, Mori, because Mori is a great partner to have in the field. We've been in the desert, we've been in the mountains, and it's always good to have Mori at your side. So.
Yeah, well, we've had the luck this year of going to several locations that are a producer's dream to film. We've been in the desert where everything you point the camera at is picturesque, and you can't miss. Every single frame could be used in the Salton Sea story. The sun sets over these mountains by the sea, and it's this incredible sunset. In another setting, we were filming in Moab with the Moab Music Festival. And not only are we filming a classical music concert, but we're filming it in the middle of this canyon of red rock.
And that's not someplace you can drive to.
It's not. We had to hike to it. We had to bring our camera gear into the canyon.
All the musicians are carrying all their equipment. You show that in the story.
Yeah, we didn't have it as bad as them. I mean, particularly the bass player. The bass player had his giant bass strapped to his back, and he was ducking under the trees and having to move tree branches around. And we just had two tripods. But the highlight of that hike, it has to be said, is that Mori was actually charged by a ferocious baby deer.
So somehow we didn't put it in the story.
No,
that somehow didn't get put in. We were grabbing some extra shots of the nature around the concert, and we see this deer approach us, and you know, I'm getting closer with the camera and thinking, this is incredible, I'm getting this close of a shot. And the deer starts getting closer to me, and I'm like, wow, I'm really staying in there getting my shot, and it starts to gallop a little bit and charge and kind of pick up its hooves. And about 10 feet from me, I realized, ooh, this is very close to me. I probably should put my camera down and see if I'm in trouble here.
But you know, the thing is that we're bringing this up partly, Mori, not just to embarrass you, but you're on a streak of these kind of bizarre moments that are happening only to you compared to anybody else that we have. You come back and you have video of these things happening.
I do. It's doing everything to get the shot.
Yeah.
Sometimes that includes when we were in Calgary crashing on a bike on a mountain trail. We had a GoPro strapped to my bike as I was following a person we were profiling. And
he made a really cool wheelchair bike.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is for a story that hasn't run yet. We went and visited with a fellow named Christian Bagg, and when he was 20, he broke his back snowboarding and has spent the last 22 years working on an all-terrain wheelchair. It's got two front tires and one giant tire in the back. And he has successfully built this machine that allows him to go extreme mountain biking. So we strapped GoPros everywhere, and we had him on Christian, and we had him on Mori's bike and my bike. And proceeding down, we were actually toward the end of the ride at this point, and we're going down the mountains. We're feeling really good at this point.
I had already taken a couple tumbles off the bike, so I was feeling iffy.
But we've got the footage of Mori flipping up over the handlebars.
Good. My body's taking a beating.
The thing is, there's actually nothing in your way that you flipped over. That's what I'm kind of. Yeah. Was there a big rock? Was there a surprise baby deer? Yeah. Nope.
There wasn't. No.
Not a flashback.
I had no excuse for this one. Yeah. Just.
The other part of the story that's funny, and I was thinking about this last night. We were about halfway through the ride, and I said to the guys, the Canadians, I said, "Do we have to worry about bears?" And they were like, "Yeah, you do." And they're like, "Do you know what you're supposed to do?" I was like, ride away really fast, and you're like, absolutely not. So we're midway through the mountains.
So what do you do?
But they basically said a bear won't eat something that's not running. So stay still.
Yeah. Wow, news you can use here.
Exactly.
At the end of the year.
And that one of the guys that was with us pointed out, he's like, oh yeah, I've got this bear spray with me. You know, the two New York guys are.
Well, and my difficulty on the bike and the risks there really just highlight how amazing it is that Christian can go out there on this 3D printed wheelchair, and I'm crashing. I crashed four times on that mountain. Yeah. Christian,
no problem.
Yeah,
speeding past me.
You'll notice that there's no one behind us and no one in front of us because we have to walk.
I'm really excited about this story, just because it's a story about technology, because he's making a lot of the parts with his 3D printer, but it's also the story of innovation. And the highlight for him isn't that he's out there in the mountains, he's that I'm out there with my friends and I'm having an experience just like they are. They don't have to worry that I'm going to slow them down.
Right.
We're going just as fast as I went 20 years ago. So.
Yeah, he's not left behind.
No.
Yeah. You know, this reminds us that we use all kinds of cameras in all kinds of places, and you and I did a piece about Lyft and Uber and what's happening in the New York City taxi system. And there's scenes in the beginning where, you know, if you weren't watching, you wouldn't have known that Laura's in the back seat trying to get this shot in every way possible. And every once in a while, your head just sort of drifts up there and drifts back.
Andy Gonzalez, who drives for both, began with Uber shortly after the company first came to New York 7 years ago. He drove me and my producer, Laura, who's filming in the back seat.
I didn't have a good way to monitor whether or not I was in the shot of the GoPro. And of course, I wanted to make the piece good. I had to get a shot of you, Hari. So I sometimes had to cross over. And lo and behold, there was a shot we wanted to use where I was in the background, so.
Yeah, but it's okay. I mean, this is a team effort, and I think yeah. a lot of things that our viewers miss is that there's not just the one person that appears on camera doing this, but there's people back in the newsroom that are helping put the scripts together. There's editors that are working to make this stuff look good. There's a lot of people that are involved in this process. What happened with that Lyft story? Has anything changed?
You know, New York is still very much an anomaly, especially in the U.S. market in terms of these ride-hailing apps like Uber and Lyft. Like, we're still the only city here that has put some sort of cap. And it's technically only a year-long cap. It means that it could change after this year while they study the flow of traffic and how it will affect the city.
Since 2011, the number of for-hire vehicles licensed in New York City has more than doubled, from 50,000 to about 130,000 cars, all required to be licensed by the city's Taxi and Limousine Commission. The majority of the new cars are used for app services like Uber and Lyft.
You also got a chance to do something this year that I think anybody of a certain generation is so completely envious of, which is to skate with Tony Hawk.
I did. Now, the caveat is, it was as if Black Sabbath was playing a concert, and I was the Carpenters, and I jumped up midway through Black Sabbath's set and interrupted them. But for me, it was pretty amazing.
About 2 months before his 50th birthday, Tony Hawk set out to revisit 50 of the tricks he has invented or pioneered during his 41 years as a skateboarder.
First of all, it's amazing. I mean, let's just realize that this is a 50-year-old doing what he's doing physically. Yeah. In, you know, regardless of whether it's skateboarding, he's in phenomenal shape yeah. and really good at what he does.
And as he tells us in the piece, no yoga, no special diet, he surfs.
Nowadays, I really have to work at it. And so if I do get hurt, I'm the one doing the icing and doing and getting the mobility back and starting low and starting slow. And it's just more work.
Tony Hawk's cultural footprint is substantial. And it may seem a bit odd that he's appearing on a news program like this, but you know, his foundation has built over 600 skate parks around the world. Over an estimated 6 million people use those skate parks every year. And he's also involved in international organizations that are championing skateboarding and education. He's involved with this group called Skatistan, and they've built schools and skate parks in South Africa and Afghanistan. And what's amazing is that he talks a lot about, you know, skateboarding in places like Afghanistan, it's viewed as a toy. So there's no gender dynamics there. The people are saying it's okay for the girls and boys to go skateboarding because it's a toy. And you know, skateboarding as an activity, I'm revealing myself, I was a lifetime skater. Now I really basically only skate with my daughter. But skateboarding as an activity is something that it's really done by the individual. There's no league, there's no team, there's no ref, and there's no bar for what you need to do or be able to do. But it's also about falling. You know, you fall down a lot. And it may be sound hyperbolic, but the idea of falling and getting back up is something that's really important.
Well, Mori, just in case the audience can't tell, you guys are slightly different generations.
Yeah.
But it's amazing how long his brand has kind of gone through all these different iterations, and he's still
very relevant. Yeah. And you know, everybody who I told about this story was jealous of me for getting to go report on this. And it also was a rare opportunity to see someone who has been following Tony Hawk and skateboarding for so long meet yeah. the man, Tony yeah. Hawk. I mean, you rarely get to yeah. see
sort
a friend
of a
and colleague.
Fanboy yeah. moment.
Hero.
We yeah. walked into the office, which is just outside of San Diego, and you know, he has all of these amazing things on the wall. And the fellow who was taking us around, this really nice guy, he said, oh, well, you know, you could shoot here, you could shoot on the ramp. And I was like, I'm just going to need a minute here. Let me just take all this in.
It's Tony Hawk's private, personal half-pipe.
Yeah. So I'm just going to need a minute. Yeah. yeah.
The mecca of skating, really.
Yeah. Well, and the skating came up because Tony, we did the interview, and then he said he skated for us. And he said, oh, you should have brought your board. And I was like, well, if you have a helmet, I'll happily do it. And, you know, 30 seconds later, I'm suiting up with the helmet, and off we go. And like I said, I did feel like I was interrupting something, but it was still pretty cool.
Any kind of overall recollections? It's been a nutty news cycle this year. You guys have had lots of opportunities to go do all kinds of interesting things. Any reflections on either the state of the industry or any kind of topics that have stuck out to you?
You know, this is such a unique time, as we hear day in and day out. I feel remarkably lucky to work for the PBS NewsHour Weekend because we are able to go a bit slower. You know, we're able to take time with stories and really, I think, give heart to things and to explain things. we see online our audience is growing. Our audience is growing on television as well. That's really encouraging.
Maureen and Laura, what do you guys look for when, before you pitch a story to us and say, hey, we really want to go out in the field and do this, what are the things that kind of light you up and say, this could make for an interesting piece?
I think it's so important to find those stories that connects with everyone. And in sometimes in New York, with the story that we did, it seems like it's a New York story, but really it's a story that could be happening other cities as well.
I think what I look for in a story is giving people the chance to learn more that they won't get from the headlines, in a way where if they're talking to a friend about the news of the day, they can say, well, I watched the PBS NewsHour Weekend, and there's actually this interesting wrinkle to that story you might not have heard about, and it really changed the way I feel about what we're all reading and talking about.
You know, the narrative is that we're divided. And I feel that when we go out into the country, it doesn't feel divided. Yes, it feels different depending on where you are in the country, but when you get down and actually talk with people and talk with them about their experience, the noise goes away and it gets a lot simpler. How that manifests itself in politics, I'll leave for others to talk about, but I find that encouraging.
All right. Laura Fong, Mori Rothman, Christopher Booker, thank you all.
Thanks.